All right. Hello, hello.
No.
Is this the blob?
Why? What is this? What? No, it's. Listen, guys.
Wait, did I just hear a second lobster?
Yeah, there we go.
What is going on?
Is this still your favorite game? I hate this
not,
game.
Is this the lobster game?
No, it's not. They don't have guns
this game,
in this,
this game
one.
Looks worse.
Bro, this guy's got a sniper rifle in his mouth.
Okay, so I can see where the inspiration came
Jesus
from.
Jesus Christ! Yeah.
So is this...
Wow.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's really real funny, guys, right? Uh-huh. Who's last?
All right, everyone. We have a React video. Look at the OTK Games Expo. Right? The whole action, fighting. We saw lobsters and crabs going at it. Kind of like some samurai, right, wall running stuff, a very hypnotic, trippy car racing game, just to name a few. So now we're picking back up on the Game Expo and seeing what else all these developers have to offer.
Folks, adventure games have a huge legacy, and these games are looking to continue that legacy. The first one is from Orion Games. And called Ardo.
All right. So these graphics, I don't know, it's kind of trippy. What do y'all think? Thanks for the follows, y'all. Okay, I mean, not my go-to, but I can kind of get behind this. But it really seems like they have like two different kind of styles going on. I don't know. Y'all, I mean, what are y'all thinking? Like between all these, like, see, that looks fine. I'm cool with this, I guess. It's a little different. Now, I mean, as I talked about in the previous video, not a huge fan of like Eagle Eye, you know, again, it's like when it's, you're watching your character from above, again, that doesn't really do it for me, but these, like this whole overall graphic thing, pretty interesting, like very different style. So I'm kind of curious to see what exactly this game entails. All right.
Well, Ardo definitely has a style unlike any of the games that we've seen so far today, and also it's an open world game, which I did not mention before we dove in. If it looks cool to you, good news, you can play it early. You can download the demo right now on Steam. You can also add it to your wish list for when it comes out. I just want to remind everybody at home, any of these games that you like, you can hop into the Discord, you can react to the games that you like the most, and it's going to give them a chance to win that grant that Asmund's going to be awarding at the end of the show. We got $50,000 and...
Quick reminder, everyone, right? Grants versus pledges. Grants really indicate and show a lot more commitment to actually awarding the money. Kind of I talked a little about in the last stream, which will be up on the YouTube page here. Whenever it decides to finish uploading, but right, a pledge is just saying like, hey, get this money. I'll probably end up, you know, I'll give, you know, I will donate, give however you want to word it, said money to whatever this, program is, right? Aspect. So think, right. Most recent news or where this kind of got talked about was Amber Heard, right? Remember pledging her $7.5 million to the ACLU. And she ended up not doing it, right? It are very, very minimal amount. So a pledge is just saying like, yes, you know, I promise to do this. Whereas a grant, just like in academia, where we constantly are now pretty much being incentivized to write for grants, is to earn that additional income. But once you win a grant or once you are awarded a grant, that money associated with the grant is immediately yours, right? Like there's no, okay, well, if you do the research, you do the project, we will then give the money to you. It's like, no, it's that money is yours. So one reason I'm a huge fan of how OTK is doing this is it is a strong commitment to, you know, this money will be yours, like the 50,000, it's 30,000 to first place, 20,000 to second place. So again, I think it's a fantastic idea. It's really showing a, you know, a wonderful level of commitment on, you know, on the part of OTK, this org, and helping out the developers who obviously have spent a lot of time on these variety of games.
In a beautiful PC, a Razer PC powered by Intel that the winners will be getting as well to continue developing their games and any future games which they do make. But let's hop into the next one. This one comes from Dapper Dog Digital and it's called Biogun.
It's time to get to
Dapper Dog. What? Okay. Wow, this is nice. Oh man, y'all know what that means, right? You saw the little changing of helmets? Might be some microtransactions come in. I don't know. Usually that's a good indicator. But gun look, I mean, the game looks pretty sweet though.
To be completely honest, that one reminds me of Mizkip's Closet as well. That one is also a Metroidvania. Oh. You can add it to your Steam wish list, and there is a demo available. So that is another game that you will be able to play today. I love Metroidvanias. The progression in them is always very enjoyable. And our next one is a roguelike. It's the first roguelike that we've taken a look at today. It's from Stroll Art Studios, and it's called Below the Stone.
Okay, more pixelated. Right, style game, that's fine. Ooh, it's kind of like Minecraft, just farming away, getting materials, building up. Maybe not horrible. I mean, right? Who doesn't like Minecraft or, you know, Minecraft all souped up graphics, aka New World? Oh, Monopoly Man, cool. Good to see him there. Let's see. I don't know, how many of y'all in chat are fans of these kind of games? Again, not really my cup of tea, but, you know, I've heard a lot of people, huge, you know, they get a large following. Because, like, what is it, Shovel Knight? Reminds me of that.
Yep, rocks. And Below the Stone is one of those games where I know Asmund pretty well. This is the type of art style that I think really resonates with us. Anytime that you get to see a game with that pixel art, it kind of brings you back. You start to remember some of the memories.
Yeah, so it's very nostalgic. I get that.
Actually already add it to your Steam wish list, but when we're talking about that art style, I know I want to learn a little bit more. Luckily, Asmund is going to be talking to the lead artist, Mike Stallart, right now.
Thanks, Rich. Yeah, I mean, you're definitely right. I see that art style, and I go right back to 1998, running through, like, Legend of Zelda.
Oh, man. I'm sorry, man. Digging that beard, that's some impressive, like, shaping. All right.
In the past or something.
Had to
like
say
that.
It.
I absolutely love it. And thank you so much, Mike, for coming on and sharing your game with us. And my understanding is you guys had a really interesting journey becoming and coming to the expo today. And what's the game development journey for you?
It's hard to wrap it up in you know, a small little segment, right? It's like, you know, we started, you know, myself, I didn't go to college or anything for this. I was kind of just going into it as raw as possible, right?
I
started by kind of inviting, I started with just my art, right? And invited a couple people to join me, Andrew being one of them, our lead programmer. And he, you know, we worked on Below the Stone for a while. We needed a composer for our Kickstarter later on. So we ended up picking up a composer, Karam. And, you know, we actually failed our first Kickstarter.
It happens.
What I learned, though, right, is just putting yourself out there, like, is a huge win, right? It's not about, like, the money in Kickstarter. It's really about, like, people who are fans of that make your game a success, right? And we ended up getting, like, hundreds of new fans from this Kickstarter. And eventually publishers even started contacting us. In fact, kind of funny story with our publisher, you know, our relationship, I started by blocking them. I should share that, but yeah, very smart move by me.
Yeah, and, playing hard to get.
Started by, you know, originally, you know, they contacted me. I accidentally, like, you know, I didn't know who they were. I blocked them. Then they contacted me again, blocked them again. And then I was like, and then they found my Facebook out of nowhere, right?
And oh my God, I was like, whoa.
Yeah, I was like, whoa, Facebook? All right, maybe they have something to say. So then, you know, I realized these guys were serious about our game, and they saw what we were trying to make was as important as how we thought about it as, right? And then we realized, like, you know, this is a kind of like a perfect fit for us. And, you know, it really kind of huge, you know, this... every step of the way, it's just been kind of like a twist and a turn, and, you know, hundreds of different directions for this game.
Well, I bet that must have been pretty reassuring whenever you have publishers reaching out to you like that and being so insistent about it, going and doing whatever they need to do to talk to you.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, like, seriously, I, you know, and these guys are great.
Yeah, for real. That is honestly one of the... any sort of business practice you're in, having that feeling of being wanted, that is a great way to measure your value, right? The more people want you, the more valuable you are, right? Because you have something that they want. And right, if everyone had it, then they wouldn't be trying to single you out in particular. So, right, it's just having people come to you, right, specifically seeking you, kind of like you said, right, is... it's fantastic, and that may never have happened if they didn't put themselves out there, right, in that initial Kickstarter. So as, right, good old verbiage goes, failure is sometimes the best teacher, right? You learn, you grow, even all these Twitch streamers, actually any kind of streamer in general, really, definitely myself included, as getting hold of all this, right, is... you know, how to even things like making thumbnails, sound levels, audio equipment, lighting, all these factors is it's all trial and error, right? But you will never get to figure that out for yourself and get that valuable experience if you never take that shot, right? If you keep trying to prepare yourself, right? It's, oh no, I have to be able to account for any and everything. Well, I'd like to quickly introduce you to Murphy's Law, which is simply put, if something can go wrong, it will. So no matter what, the moral of the story is, you can never be prepared for everything. You can do your best, but is it worth putting off, right, actually starting to gain valuable experience? Don't get me wrong, it's a tricky, you know, path, bridge, however you want to put it, to navigate. But overall, it's eventually you just have to go for it, right? So that's what they did.
You know, I used to not like publishers at first, but then I realized, like, these guys are real. You know, these guys are real people, you know, and then, you know, it worked out.
Yeah, I bet it seems like it has. Obviously, it has. So, like, you're talking about, like, this game. It's like a it's got, like, the pixel art a little bit to it, but it's also got a roguelike element. How does this game play?
So where we kind of separate ourselves from other roguelikes is we So like crafting and equipping gear is actually like important to your character. There's actually like a long-term progression, whereas other roguelikes, what they do is kind of like you go down until it's almost like a Diablo-esque where like you go down, you die, and then you start over. Then you go down, die, and start over. Go down, die, and start over. And like that's like super repetitive in roguelikes. So the way we do it is we make it so every time you descend, you can actually like bring resources back with you to this kingdom area. And you can actually like use that gear to progress further in the game. You can wear this stuff, but every time you go down, right, it's a roguelike. So every time you go down, you're risking that stuff that you're wearing, right?
I get it.
So it's kind of like a twist on like how normally roguelikes do it. So
okay, that's cool.
You're risking everything that you're bringing down with you.
So if you die, you lose the stuff? And everything.
Yeah, if you die, you lose all the stuff on your character.
Oh
right?
My god. That's that's intense.
That's like going into the wilderness in RuneScape.
Crafting all this gear, right?
Yeah.
You're wearing it, you decide to take on the boss, and then you realize, like, oh, I don't know how this guy works. And then, like, you start learning the pattern. You're like, oh, shit, I don't know if we're allowed to curse on stream. That might have been the first one.
It's okay.
But, but anyway, it's like every time you go down, it's like kind of like a new adventure. We have 50 biomes we're planning. We want to make it so, like, every time you go down, like, it's going to be like a completely new kind of adventure every time you go down.
Okay, so yeah, like you go down, you have no idea what's going on. It kind of almost reminds me of a game like Rust, you know, like a super high stakes game. And if you get killed, you lose all your stuff.
Yeah.
I know how crushing that is, but it's also like really, really intense. I think back like things like games I played on that like 2 years ago. I still remember them. So I'm really excited. Yeah. And if people want to enjoy your project, and they want to support it, where can they go?
Well, they can go to belowthestone.com. Okay. We got a Discord. I'm going to be sitting in the voice channel after this. If you want to, you know, wishlist the stream, great. Wishlist the stream, guys. But also wishlist Below the Stone on Steam. I also want to say hi to everyone in chat. No, I wanted to say hi for a long time, but
all right, yeah. Well, thanks a lot for coming on, man. Yeah, the game looks really cool, exciting, and I like how it's a new take on the whole roguelike thing, especially with a graphic style that I and I think a lot of other people kind of around our age resonate with really well. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Absolutely. And again, guys, if you want to add Below the Stone to your Steam wishlist, go on ahead. And again, I want to say that whenever we're doing these games, make sure that you go on to Discord. If you all want to vote on the games that you like the most for this developmental grant money to go to, please go ahead and do that and use the Discord. You guys can vote whenever you want. But anyway, we'll go back and look at some more games.
Yeah, definitely excited to do that, and I think it's really cool to hear that new take on roguelikes. You know, maybe you see overworld progression sometimes, but actually seeing taking a risk, trying to push a little bit further. I'm definitely looking forward to checking that game out, but we have one more game left in the category. It's from Bedtime Digital Games. Let's take a look.
I don't know if you can still get in time for the vote. This may already have finished up. Whoa. Oh my god, this song.
This isn't going to help anyone.
Time to make the greatest bets. Video games can't be musicals.
Hey!
Problems should be repressed. A silent fart is a wasted opportunity.
Okay, enough already.
Nobody knows all the trouble.
All right, full disclosure, that song alone, totally digged it. I love those happy but very depressing style songs, especially the fact that they got something original for this game. I'm more or less sold right there. Not to mention the animations, gameplay, very intriguing. Looks fun, so I'm definitely looking forward to this. Figment 2.
Team.
You can add that to your Steam wish list right now. But let's talk about all the games that we actually saw in this category. I'm going to throw it up to the second best gamer in OTK, NMPLOL.
Oh, the backhanded compliments. Love it.
Okay, Rich, excuse me. If I'm not the first best, then who's the first best? Sorry, we're getting distracted here. Clearly, I'm the best gamer. We just saw a whole bunch of awesome adventure games. Ardo, Biogun, Below the Stone, Figment 2. I loved them all. Chance, what was your favorite?
That's not how we're supposed to do it.
We can.
Okay. Well, out of all of those, I was going to say Ardo was my favorite initially.
Perfect. Let's do it.
I like the hack and slash, the colors being splashed around as you're kind of running through. You can see that it's like it's white and bland, but as your character moves on, it kind of unloads all those beautiful colors. But not also...
That's just so much.
Fluid. It looks good. It looks like a really solid hack and slash along with just looking gorgeous. But I'm a little torn because, you know, after hearing the dev with Below the Stone, that looks really good. You know, I like gear. Gear is so satisfying to receive. I don't know. Maybe Ardo has it too, but I'm torn, you know. All the games look really good.
Yeah.
But if I had to pick, I'd go with Ardo.
Sir, how'd you feel about Ardo?
So, Ardo is absolutely beautiful. I love that it's got a riveting soundtrack as well. I'm somebody that, like, I need to have my headphones on. I want to feel like I'm inside that game. I want my ears being, you know, pounded by good riveting soundtrack.
Yo.
But as Chance said, Below the Stone, you know, you can craft your own gear after hearing the dev. It's like a survival hardcore roguelike.
Yeah.
You don't even know what he was talking about.
I don't think you know what he was. You're chatting, you know. I respect it though. I'm more of a like Creed Valley type of guy.
Yeah.
The soundtrack, it sounds like a bedtime story that you never want to end, you know?
Really?
Cool shit.
Yeah.
So Creed Valley, Figment 2, that was your favorite one?
I say it's my favorite because of the soundtrack. Like, the soundtrack makes you glue your eyes on the screen. Like, it makes you want to pay attention to what's going to happen next. So,
yeah.
It was cute.
See?
It was
like,
you know, Figment had some really... we're talking about Figment, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it had some really cute music. You see the little scene where he's walking over the piano? Yep. It's very music-driven.
Crisp animation, voice acting.
Mm-hmm.
And I look forward to winning all of these games as well, Chance.
Yeah.
You literally don't even know what you...
A lot of these are adventure games. You can't really beat other people in it.
I feel like y'all gaming time has passed. Everybody at this table is like 40 plus.
Bro, no...
Oh,
excuse
shit.
Me. Excuse me. I am really good at video games. Okay.
Like,
but no one asked, but my favorite game actually so far of the four is actually Below the Stone. Like Chance and the progression and... Just being able to, you know, get gear, craft gear.
People love progression systems.
I just learned from the dev interview that, you know...
That's why Diablo Immortal is so popular.
You lose it all.
And that, to me, is really, really, really exciting.
It was interesting to see his take on the roguelike.
The only thing is going to be, right, everyone loves progression, without a doubt. It's one of the major reasons New World was so hyped up and so successful at first. But you start looking at, like... You know, RuneScape, I know I already talked about it, but it just comes to mind, right, is you craft all this gear, you loot it, however you acquire it, right, but you progress your character, and in a system where gear is basically the primary shower of your progression, then having that, you know, being risked at being just completely taken away can have negative side effects, right? People might just straight up rage quit. If they divulged hours into crafting, getting this, you know, potentially best gear. So I'm curious to see that, like, you know, if you do die, that it's all gone. Or if there's some sort of like safety system, like, you know, a lot of games, if you can run back to your corpse, loot it, then you'll recover all or maybe just some of your gear. I remember one system, was it RuneScape? Honestly, I forget. I haven't played RuneScape in ages. I just remember going into the wilderness when I finally got full rune-plated armor and getting killed. And I didn't play that game for like a week because I was so upset because you like you lost it all, or if you went back, you could recover maybe like three pieces. It was like your three highest scoring pieces, something along those lines. So I don't know. I'm curious. Again, yes, the pixelation is very nostalgic, but that's still, it's just not my preference.
Out. But another game that did stand out, no one's mentioned, Biogun looks good. You know, it's got that Metroid feel that a lot of people tend to love.
Yeah.
And I look at some of the boss fights, which
Boss fights, in my opinion, are the most important part of these kind of games, and they look solid. You know, there's a little bullet hill kind of dodging here and there. The gameplay looks fun. I get some Super Meat Boy vibes, which is a solid platformer, just kind of based on the looks of it. I saw the clip of the doctor injecting the needle, you know, so yeah. The theme of it is also awesome. The music is good. Looks like a solid game.
Yeah, mm-hmm. This game actually reminds me of an old school game like Mega Man, like back when you
were yes.
old.
Oh.
Yeah. Oh, yep. Never mind.
Yeah, I think he's 43 or something.
He just proved my point.
So, Bruce, like, how do you feel about Biogun there, huh?
I like it. Yeah. It reminds me of a computer lab game I used to play in fifth grade.
So, about 45 years ago?
No.
Yesterday?
I don't want to do quick math. That's okay. Kind of embarrassing.
Hey, Nick, which game here is more likely to keep you up past 8 p.m.?
Well, okay. We're not going to turn this into making fun.
Ouch.
Okay. I'm 27 years old. Okay, yeah. I'm young.
He's not rich, right? Okay. Rich Campbell, I believe, is the punching bag for the group.
Remember, chat, if you guys want to, you guys can vote for your favorite in Discord. Right now, it's OTK Network Discord. Make sure you go in there and vote. Yeah, I think we're ready to get a quick sandwich, go to the bathroom.
Good job, Nick.
And we'll be right back after these commercials.
Commercials.
We just got to watch a little peek from one of our sponsors about eating brains, but now we have a whole game category for the glowy brains. It's one of my favorite types of games. It's none other than strategy.
Okay.
When we're actually looking at these strategy games, we have a huge list of very different types of games. So I'm excited to just peel through this category. The first one is unlike anything I've really ever seen before. Asma and I have spent a lot of time talking about this one. It's from Tucana Interactive, and it's called Dwarf Romantic.
Okay. Whoa. Oh, hexagon tiling. I love it. Yeah. Oh my god, is it like, Settlers of Catan? Oh. I don't know about you, chat, but I'm digging this. This is my kind of strategy, right? Cute worlds. All right.
That one looks really relaxing to play. I'm very excited to actually check it out. The first time that we watched that trailer with Asmund, he actually turned to me and he went, "Wow, dude, look at that tree, dude. Wow. That was cool.
It's a cool tree."
That's pretty good impression.
Yeah, and you guys, you can play it right now. It's already available on Steam, so you can go ahead and download it. But we got a little bit more to look at.
I might just do that.
The strategy category. This one's coming from Sunspear Games, and it's called Immortal Gates of Pyre.
Oh, huge suspense. Be right back getting some water now that the coffee's gone. All right, see? Everyone missed me. Missed you too. Don't worry. We are back. Just calling it. Very getting some hardcore StarCraft II vibes from this, which I love. But
price slows down, and this is an awful fight for Santa. He's gonna get back into the protection, but I'm not sure that's gonna be enough.
Spend his money on a citadel. This could be a really good one.
Four strikes coming down through the whole army. It's all clones because now they're all dead.
More
in the main, and there's no alloy coming in because there's been Safari in the back of the base.
Oh, no, there's no AC.
I'm sorry, y'all. This is... This is... perhaps a little too much, just like StarCraft 2. So... alright. We'll finish it.
Getting to take a look at an RTS game definitely gets me very excited. I don't think I'd be standing in this arena right now if it wasn't for the RTS genre and everything that it did do for esports. So getting to look at a game following in that legacy, very, very inspiring. But we also get to talk to the game director, Coulter, and he is with Asmund right now. Let's hear about the RTS.
Okay. Hey, what's going on, Coulter? How you doing?
I'm doing great, man. It's good to be on stream. What's up, chat?
It's good to have you here. I mean, honestly, it's been a long time since we had an RTS game come out. I mean, I'm sure you remember just as well as I do, is the new Command & Conquer every single year, a new Age of Empires. Now there's not a whole lot anymore. So what inspired you to make this game?
So we started right when the big dip in RTS being released happened, and it just it basically came down to we absolutely wanted to
one sec y'all having some minor issues. Just getting some major lag spikes, so don't want to subject y'all to that. Trying to have a relatively smooth video flow. Okay. Think that did it.
Share with your friends.
Hi, right, my apologies.
Armies with a friend, seeing stuff blow up in that big spectacle way. That's something we tried to do, but people just kept bouncing off the difficulty curve. I mean, sometimes RTSs are infamous for it. And that's something we set out to solve so that, like, you could share with your friends or you could have fun in this genre in a way that you haven't been able to do before. So that's really what it was all about. And now we're seeing a renaissance. There are so many RTS games in development, some of them very big titles. And so we are working to redefine what RTS means to so many people who have felt excluded from the genre, while still delivering that hardcore competitive experience for people who want that.
Well, like, whenever you talk about differentiating yourself from, like, the other games, and, like, you're definitely right. Like, I think that, what is the StarCraft, you have to have 180, 200 APM or something like that now. It's it's crazy how high the skill gap gets with these RTS games. So what's different about Immortal versus...
You know, it's sad. Mine, last time I played with friends, and this was Brood War that we were doing. Because it lets you know, I think my APM capped at, like, 82. So that's equivalent of a PE grade of needs improvement, unsatisfactory. But I still came in second most matches. Just we had a friend, we have that one friend, right, who StarCraft was their life, and he's anywhere between like 160 and 180. So literally more than doubling me on most occasions. And yeah, you can figure out why he was winning.
A lot of these other strategy games. Like, can you get into a little bit of that?
Yeah, so during that time, early on in our development, we were really focused on, okay, how can we deliver that depth? We've seen other people attempt to make the genre more accessible, and they'll lose the magic in the process by oversimplifying. And so this was a massive effort to really see, okay, can we do this? Can we get the silver bullet we haven't seen before? And so this was really a community thing. We started as a team of modders. We added industry professionals as we went along. But ultimately, we got that hardcore delivering experience with that much, much more fun, can jump into it. You only need to know three buttons to play Immortal. And
how
we let you get to the fun with three buttons, which is just completely unlike what's come before.
Okay.
Yeah, that's definitely a great thing. I think that especially, like, I mean, even games like Age of Empires that seem like super simple, they become incredibly complex by how seriously the players make them and everything like that. And I guess I want to ask, like, so for strategy fans, anybody like that, how can they support this project?
So the thing that they can do is tune into our Discord. We're in closed alpha right now. There are keys going out via the streamers that we work with and via our Twitter. So the Discord should be posted in the chat here. So jump in there, check out what's going on. And because we're that community-oriented company, we really want to get your feedback, your first impressions, and if you get a key, your first experiences.
I think that makes a lot of sense, especially since you're a team of modders and everything. So you're very used to kind of taking something and then, you know, appreciating that feedback and that iteration.
Yeah, I took the words out of my mouth, right? Is modders, that's what they thrive off of, is looking, you know, playing a game, kind of seeing like either, man, what's wrong? How can I make it better? What's something I would do? And then they do it. But furthermore, right, it's like community feedback, right? One of the biggest success stories is from being, you know, conceived from a modder is, right, you have Counter-Strike Global Offensive, you know, being a mod from Half-Life, as well as Dota, right, Defense of the Ancients from Warcraft 3. Not Reforged, we won't talk about that, but the original, right? And look, those have spawned their own series, right? They're now these huge Counter-Strike and actually Dota both, right? They're these huge esport enterprises that have these massive competitions, huge cash prizes, like all those stemmed from, you know, modders, right? So I think it's pretty cool to have, you know, get a group of modders who are used to kind of, in a sense, thinking outside the box, right? Based on, you know, you have this game formula, this setup. How can you expand upon it? How can you change it up? You know, some work, many don't. Again, it's a lot of it's trial and error, but I think that's pretty cool. And the one bit that really stands out to me, especially as we've seen with a lot of major companies, right? World of Warcraft's been a huge one. They finally started listening to community feedback. It's a major issue, right? Is people, these companies, you know, they have these huge forums, right? For people to post about bugs, about issues, things that like don't really seem to be you know, vibing well with the majority of the player base. And a lot of cases, like, again, World of Warcraft was doing this for the past couple expansions, they'd kind of just shrug it off. Now it's, you know, with the new expansion Dragonflight, they've seemed to have finally taken all that feedback and actually applied it. Perhaps a little too late, again, time will tell us that. So just point being, I think it's fantastic that, you know, you have this group of developers, you know, former modders who are very well accustomed to taking in player feedback, right? Having that, you know, kind of connection is such an integral part of building a community around a game that will truly help a game thrive.
And so that's really great to hear. Thanks a lot for coming on Culture. I really appreciate it and good luck with the game.
Thank you.
Like, I'm really happy to see these kinds of games, man. I am. Like, it's been a long time since we've had some strategy games come out, and it's nice to see them.
Yeah, and there's so many different, like, kind of subgenres inside
of
strategy.
Yeah, I think that's starting to what's starting to happen, at least. So, yeah, guys, join the Discord if you want to be a fan of Immortal, and we'll go on to the next one.
Yeah, you talk about all the different subgenres that are going on inside of strategy. We're going to be taking a look right now at a tower defense. It's called Spirits of the Hellements, and it's from Hippo Rider Games.
Ooh, Hippo Riders. I like that. I also love tower defense, so I am definitely biased. Oh, and I love hexagons. Whoa, okay. That's okay. Oh. Yeah, okay, I mean, I apologize, this reason that's kind of getting to me is like, some of the most recent tower defense games I kind of like played, again, they're mobile, but the map was preset, right? So you couldn't alter course at all, right? So this is just taking me back to, again, talk about another phenomenal mod, right, of tower defense in Warcraft. I know they had the level, and but obviously that got expanded upon. But, you know, right, is at least in the modded version, where you place the towers could alter, you know, how the enemies would navigate to your final point. Whoa. Spirit of the Elements. All right.
Looking forward to taking more of a look at a tower defense as well to try to see, you know, how many mobs are actually coming out at a time, how the game actually all comes together.
Oh, I think that looks really cool, especially the fact that you can change the lanes. Like, there's not a lot of tower defense games to let you do that unless you go to, like, Warcraft 3 custom games or something like that.
So, see? Yeah, he knows. Really cool.
Yeah, it's been a little while since we have seen a game like that. Yeah. We're going to take a deeper look soon. We're going to get to talk about these games, but we have one more inside of this genre, and it's from Tragsoft, and it is called Coromant.
Huh. All right, I guess. Oh, Pokemon. oh, I guess kind of. That's. Again, kind of with Immortal. This is too much like Pokemon, y'all. So I'm not super interested. It looks great though. Like, I mean, I think the whole different biomes phenomenal. Oh, come on, the Ash Ketchum hat too.
Is now available for download on Steam, so if you want to check it out, you can do just that. But I want to check out all of these games just a little bit more, and lucky for us, Asmund is standing by with Emeru and Tectone to talk about everything that we saw in strategy.
I mean, I'll have to say, I am, to be completely honest, like, I'm really excited for Immortal. Like, I think that game looks really cool. And as somebody who played a lot of StarCraft 2 whenever it first came out, and all RTS games from like the 2000s and the 90s, I am just super hyped about it. But what do you guys think? Amy, what do you think?
I think the game that stands out to me most is Spirits of the Elements. I've always been a big fan of TD games since I was a kid playing Bloons in the computer lab. And I think that something that separates good TD games from okay ones is visuals and sound effects. And there was a lot going on in that trailer that
it's
was
like badass explosion.
Yeah, like it really draws you in.
Yeah, 100%. Yeah. Tecton, what do you think?
When I came here, I wanted to see innovation and modernized version of the classics. Yeah. And that's what I saw. People have been saying that gaming's been dead for years. Today, I feel like a little bit of life was breathed into the whole gaming sphere.
I think that's one of the best things about going and looking at a lot of these indie games is that people have like these ideas, and it can be small studios. You have games like Vampire Survivors, right? One, two guys make this game. It's a massive hit. Everybody plays it. And that's really what we try to do with the whole event here is we try to put a spotlight on games that we think could be the next one of those. And
honestly, I think the tower defense game looks really cool too.
Yeah.
I played a little bit of Bloons before, and I got to the expert stages, and I kept getting, I got my ass beat, I'm gonna be honest. And I stopped playing a game. I got so upset, and so I might try this one out too, just to see what it's like.
And like gameplay is super important, but like, dude, I'm 1 year older than NMP, and that dude's been having a midlife crisis for about a decade now. Like, I'm not too worried about the gameplay anymore. I want to hear good soundtracks and art style. Ardo, oh my god, looked amazing. Spell is Figment 2 looked beautiful, and the soundtrack of Beneath the Rock.
Yeah.
There's been some real good shit.
Yeah. I think the sound and everything like that does really make a big difference. Is that
it does.
Like, especially like what Emmy you were talking about with like having the graphics and like the explosions, just having them be visually appealing. Mm-hmm. Like this stuff happens, it's on the screen and just pops off. Like
it has
that's
to be
so
satisfying.
Important.
Yes.
Yeah.
Like the visual appeal of Neo Dash 2. Good lord. Yeah. It looks beautiful.
I think this is really funny because like you probably sat up here, like we're talking about like just a certain amount of games, strategy games. Bro, you're bringing up all the games.
Oh yeah,
like,
I'm getting sensory overload. There's been so many bangers.
Just so excited.
I understand that. I feel the same way, man. Like I'm very, very excited. Especially especially the Immortal game, right? Like I see this and it reminds me of like, you know, StarCraft 2. It gives me that same vibe. And I am just so excited to see that. Especially like I'm really curious to know like what do they mean about like making it easier to do, right? Like what's the
three buttons.
How do you have to play it? Like, what's it really about? And that's what I'm really curious about as well.
Yeah, like with the tower defense, too. Like, I have no idea how they're going to do, what is that, open lane tower defense?
Yeah.
I've never seen that, ever.
I have no idea. Yeah, I haven't played hardly any tower defense games at all. But I've done, like, I guess a little bit of the Warcraft 3 ones and then also the Bloons. And as I said, every single time I do it, I just try to make a bunch of the most powerful units. And then whenever that stops working, I usually rage quit the game. So I'm curious to see how far I'll go
with
this.
You have to try new strategies.
Yeah, that's the part where it doesn't work because I beat my head on the wall until I break through. You know, but there's some games that just don't let me do that. And I'm excited, especially whenever you have, like, these more off-the-wall solutions. Because I think really what, you know, Tekton, you were saying about, like, gaming being dead.
Yeah.
Right? What does that really mean? It means, like, the ideas that...
Yeah, Chad, while we're still on the section, let me know, what was your favorite strategy game that they brought up, right? I think there are tons of great contenders. Yes, some very similar, you know, they're talking about Immortal right now, that hardcore StarCraft 2 vibe. But... I mean, to be frank, it is very much like a lot of the old school RTSs, not just StarCraft. So, you know, credit where credit is due. I think it's fantastic. I am incredibly interested in this whole, you know, it only takes three buttons. You know, if we're talking about simplicity, that's, I don't know. I'm mostly just curious to see how that's going to work out. But yeah, let me know down in the comments. Feel free, you know. Yeah, just let me know what stood out to you.
People have had for like, let's say 15 years for game like tower defense, right? It's something that like for the first time, you think to yourself, you know what? Maybe it doesn't actually have to play like that. Maybe, you know, we don't need to have like established lanes. Maybe it doesn't need to do this exact thing. Same with Immortal.
Exactly, because like there's a lot of companies that are like afraid to innovate. Like we're like break, like why try something new when you can already do what you know what works? But like, I think we've seen a lot of innovation tonight, 100%.
Oh, I'm very excited. I certainly am. Like I think I might try the. I'm probably gonna play that that Helmets game. I am.
Yeah.
I think I'm gonna see what it's like. Yeah, absolutely. But I want to say again, is that just make sure that you guys vote for the games that you guys enjoy a lot. We're gonna have the Discord link again in chat. It's on the OTK Network Discord because, as I said before, $50,000 as well as some PCs, some Razer PCs powered by Intel are going to be provided for you all today and for these different studios that win. So anyway, I'm pretty much good. Hey, how do you guys feel about them?
Good.
Yeah, I'm excited.
All right. Well, Rich, go on ahead. I'm ready.
Yeah, you know, I'm very excited for this next genre. As somebody who's been told that he looks like Luigi his entire life, the next category definitely really does resonate with me. It's time for platformers.
All right. Before it gets underway, my dog just woke up. So he is a old fur baby, but he is still precious. So I have to go let him out right quick and then come back to y'all. So one sec. All right. Sorry about that, y'all. He's a very happy boy now. He's running around and enjoying life. Platformers, not my best genre.
Resonates with me as well, because when you actually do look at how the controls work, the legs are going to be even more awkward than my jokes. It's Lock Pickle's new game, Robotry.
Cool name. Oh, what? I wonder if the name stems from the debauchery that's gonna take place once you start going. Because I can definitely see that happening.
Excited to see everything Robotry will bring.
No, thank you.
You can add it to your Steam wishlist right now, so you can see as soon as it is available. Now, the next game is unlike anything that we've seen yet today. It's from Biscuit Locker, and it's called The Cat Box Paradox.
Oh, no. What? Oh man, that's you have to be fast with those changes. This is gonna be one of those challenging games. I'm sure there's gonna be quite a few speedruns. Right? Like, it makes me think of stuff like, you know, Battletoads, where you need, you know, learn the map and then get those, you know, transitions between, you know, black, white, down incredibly fast as you're moving around. Getting the best time. So to me, that's what I foresee with a game like this are people who love speedruns and extremely challenging maps. Just my thoughts.
I'm really cheering for that little guy. When you actually do watch the cat running around, you think about the Schrodinger paradox and how it's both alive and dead at the same time, much like my streaming career. But for this one, we actually do get to hear more about the game's development. This is one of the most heartwarming stories that I actually got to hear leading into the Games Expo. Asmund's going to be talking to both of the devs right now. They're named Mr. Ben and Mr. Bobs, and they actually put this game together right around the beginning of COVID as a way to kind of stay in touch. I don't want to say too much about it. I'll let them actually talk about the creation of the game. And you can actually download Catbox Paradox right now. It's available for download on Steam. So if you want to check it out during the Games Expo, you can go ahead and do that before we take even this deeper look at what went into the development process and what the game's all about and what the goal actually was for making this game. Because like I said a little bit earlier, it really is one of those games that going into the Games Expo, we heard the story about the game's development, and that was one of the reasons that we did want to put it into the spotlight and actually get to check it out. We only have 3 games as well in the platformer category, so after we check out this interview, we're going to be jumping into the last one. And we have a few more genres as well. We're going to take a look at some of the genres that we are going to be looking at today as we get ready for that interview. We already, I think, covered about 4 of them. Next up, we're going to be taking a look at party games. From there, we're going to be taking a look at shooters as well.
And oh.
I believe after that, we're going to be getting into the simulation games. I'm very excited to check out that category and see everything that Seer has to say about that. But when we do put our attention back on the platformers, we have a lot of surprises in the final game as well. And for the Catbox Paradox, we do have that interview getting ready very shortly here with Asmongold. So I can see Asmongold right now, very excited to get his chance to actually talk about it. Asmongold, what did you think about that game?
I thought it was cool, man. Like, I gotta go back and watch the trailer so the cat goes black and white back and forth. I think that's pretty, like, I've never seen something that does that before. And I think it's an interesting game. I think that's one of the coolest things about looking at some of these games is like taking a completely new idea, a completely new perspective on something and trying something that, especially, I think one aspect of this that's really underplayed is the visual identity of it, because it looks very appealing. It looks like something that you've never really seen something like that before in the same way. Obviously, like the graphics, again, I forgot who it was that mentioned this. It was Bruce talking about games they played in the computer lab in fifth grade. I think I was doing that back whenever I was about high school at that time. And so, yeah,
I was in high school, ninth grade, chemistry. And the teacher loved my friend and I so much, right? You know, it's being a good student, all that kind of jazz. Well, it gets you perks. And so he and I both got, we downloaded Halo, right? Combat Evolved onto a couple of flash drives. So we asked if we could go on the back and like, there were some computers. And she's like, yeah, sure. So we go in the back, plug those bad boys in, and then we start playing Halo. We'd start doing some multiplayer or like campaign, co-op. Did they have co-op? Yeah, they had co-op. I just know we were killing each other, but after a couple of weeks, we had to stop because other students were like, what? They get to play Halo? And I was like, well, yeah, because, you know, we finished the work. So then we were just sitting in class for like 20, you know, minutes every day just sitting there doing nothing. The good old days. Now, in the actual computer class and the computer lab, we played Quake 4. And that got intense that we started having like 12 people playing it because we just started loading it up on all the computers. So we got in trouble because one of the assistant principals walked by the class. And of course, it's like this huge, you know, the back, there's no wall. It's all just like glass and could clearly see in and just like, you know, some people working on some work, and then you just see all these people playing Quake and killing him. Yeah, they got shut down. So, good times, though, nevertheless.
Love these games. I think they're really cool. And especially whenever they have, like, a cool little gimmick like that, that gives you a little bit of, like, kind of a, you know, back and forth. And the co-op game, jumping around and everything, you like that?
Yeah, I mean, that's one of those games where instantly you know you're going to see a lot of streamers play it and they're going to freak out. Like, you'll even see the people who, you know, as much as they try, they stream, but they're not necessarily good at games. You know, like Quinn, I am currently better than him at Diablo. It's not a huge deal. But you know what is a huge deal? How great the Catbox Paradox does look. I just got word that the interview is ready. Asmund, let's actually learn about the game.
All right, yeah, I'm very excited about this. So thank you all very much, Mr. Ben and Mr. Bobs, for joining us. And I'm really kind of curious.
Oh, nice. Double.
You all have a pretty interesting story of how you became friends and when you guys started making games together. So how did it all happen?
We started making games when we were children, back in school. And we made games on the Sinclair ZX Spectrum. We programmed them in BASIC. And we released them on tape.
Oh, wow.
For a long time ago.
Yeah.
And then it was a brief hiatus of 30 years, I think. And then we thought we'd have a go again. So we took up Godot during lockdown and tried to make a game. And kind of prototyped a few ideas. And then it just kind of went on from there, really.
That is crazy. So 30 years y'all went on hiatus, came back, you make this game, it's on the Xbox.
It's a hell of a hiatus.
That's a cool story. I mean, that a lot.
That's like,
game about is like the cat, like it changes color.
Absolutely. So as you mentioned, it's based on the Schrodinger's cat paradox about a cat being both simultaneously dead or alive, and we've sort of symbolized that with the black and white colors. So during the game, you can switch using the button.
Just all right, see, we got it. We got it.
And as a black cat, you can't touch anything that's white. And as a white cat, you can't touch anything that's black. Although that's quite a simple mechanic overall, we've really had fun trying to see sort of where that idea can take us. And, you know, we've hopefully come up with lots and lots of ideas, making a kind of fast-paced and fun little, with lots and lots of variety as well, a little platform game.
I think it looks pretty cool. Like, I can see it being one of those things where it's like, it seems really simple to do, and then whenever you actually start playing the game, you just get your ass beat. And so I'm pretty excited to
I'm telling y'all, it's going to be a competitive.
What was your goal with making this game?
Really just have a bit of fun and challenge ourselves and sort of make something like we wanted to make when we were kids in that kind of era. But obviously we couldn't. And then nowadays it's so much easier. So much better. So yeah, it was really just to have a bit of fun, and we got a lot of positive feedback from playtesters and players, and then we just thought, well, we should put it out there.
That is honestly, like, for me personally, I think that's really cool, because whenever I was a kid, I did like animation and other types of stuff like that, and it's like, back then the technology you had was just like so much worse. So like going back and seeing what people are capable of doing now and like really kind of finishing the unfinished is really awesome. So thank you guys so much, and the game is available right now on Steam, is that right?
Oh, awesome. Word.
Awesome. Yep. Okay, yeah. So if anybody wants to go and play Catbox Paradox, you can go ahead and do that right now on Steam. Thank you very much, Mr. Bob and Mr. Ben. I appreciate it, and good luck with the future of your game.
Wow, that's crazy, though. Have a friendship and a passion go that long to take that big of a break?
I think that's really cool. Like, me and two of my friends, whenever we were in, on summer vacation, we made these, like, animation games together, and I don't know. It's like very nostalgic for me to see that, even though it's never really happened to me. It's just like, I remember how cool that was, and seeing two guys come together and do that after so many years is just very personal for me.
Yeah,
so.
No, it's a great thing to see. And also when you start to look at the mechanics of it as well, that simple mechanic has a lot of potential to really just change how the entire game does work. But we have one more game here in our platformers that we are going to be talking about. And for this one, I don't know what else to say besides the fact that my excitement is almost as huge as its creator's ego. This one is made by Mizkif, and it's called Unrooted.
Oh. Okay. Let's see how biased they are for this. Oh. We'll see. I'm 50-50. Like, some of the gameplay graphics, it's like, wow, that's really, I thought it was like fantastic. I think it's something about the bees, kind of bugged me, no pun intended. But it looked like, you know, the whole being able to stretch out, like, the kind of niche, game mechanic seemed pretty cool. So let's see what they have to say.
If you want to stay up to date with everything with this game, you can follow them on Twitter right now, @UnrootedGame. And we're going to get to talk to the developer of the game just a little bit more, Mizkif. He's sitting with Asmin and Emeru right now. Let's hear about Unrooted.
Yeah, this game has actually been a passion project for the past 2 years. I've been, I'm actually kind of nervous about this because I know people have been asking about this game. I've gotten hundreds of Reddit posts.
That look. What does
it look like when I'm shouting out my game?
Oh, no, I was thinking about something else, that's all.
So just not paying attention.
A lot of people have been asking about this game, and I'm super excited to finally talk about it. Basically, how it happened is I was at an airport, and I was playing platformers. I've been playing platformers pretty much every day for the past 2 years. I love Jump King. I love
Jump King.
Platformers.
Yeah.
Jump King is really good. And I always wanted to be able to make one of these games.
I always wanted to create one, and I thought the best way to do it was with my community. But it wasn't. Because what happened was, I hired a bunch of people from my community, and they all lied about what their resumes were, and they actually couldn't do anything.
Oh, yeah. I've done that before. Yeah.
Yeah.
So I had to rehire a bunch of people, and I was able to hire an amazing team from my community still. We have some crowd favorites, this girl named Courtney. She's in my chat right now. And we have Coaster Music as well, who makes a lot of the music in the game. And it's just been a crazy project for the past 2 years. I never knew how expensive making a game really was.
So speaking of expensive, how many microtransactions are you going to have in the game?
Well, I was getting to that. So right now, you know, it's an expensive game. We will have NFTs available right after this.
Okay.
So if you guys want to follow the Unrooted Twitter, it is Unrooted Game on Twitter,
there you
I believe.
Go.
But yeah, it's just a passion project that we've been working on. The artwork is fantastic.
So yeah, anyway,
so,
guys,
yeah,
Unrooted, I think
cat
it's
game.
Great.
Cat game?
The cat. I like the cat game too. Like,
yeah,
honestly,
oh, that's mean.
It was like a really cool,
come on,
like back and forth where you could go in the black and white, and it was like life and death and all that kind of stuff. It was a really, really new idea that just completely changed everything.
Yeah, I like the zero gravity stuff on the platforms.
Yeah, that's yeah, cool. You go up in the air.
Sorry, that just that meme from Loki. It's like, yes, yes, that's fantastic. Anyways, so. Oh, just so dismissive. Gotta love it.
You fly around. I mean, Miz, the Catbox game was good, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, the Catbox game was very good. I like the devs. They're very nice. My devs are actually great, too. But the cat game was fantastic. I love it. I think chat's gonna love this one. It's very creative. And the devs working together, it's a very nice story.
It's a very nice story. I certainly like it a lot. And all right. Okay. No memes. That's the first time I really saw the trailer. It actually looks pretty good, dude.
You right?
Yeah, it looks awesome.
It actually looks good.
So we actually copied Ori and the Blind Forest because that game sold.
That's good because you just do
something
that somebody else does.
Yeah.
So it's like
chat game. Called it.
Exactly. You're talking to me.
Hey.
I know you're going to react to this when you go home.
No, of course. Yeah, I'll be like, wow, that was a good joke. I was really funny there. Yeah, true. True myself. Exactly.
But yeah, chat, for any of these games that you guys see right now, you can head over.
Oh man, see, move the. They're having like the interviews, like the panels, like more up top. So I was like, oh, that works great. But then they switched them back below. So back to up there we go. Okay.
Over to the Discord, which is, I believe, the OTK Discord. Mm-hmm. Go ahead over there. There is a panel or a place you can vote for all the games. Like Asmund said, first place gets $30,000. I believe second place gets $20,000, right?
Yep, and they both get a Razer PC that's got Intel inside of it too. Intel stuff,
nice.
Powered by Intel. I think that's a lot, especially, I mean, PC is getting a whole gaming PC now, especially, I don't know really how bad the clip shortage is now, but it's over $1,000. That's a lot of money. So
dude,
for people that want to develop a game and actually render it and make it work the way they want, I think this is a tremendous bonus for them because you got to keep in mind, like, for
yeah, so I was just looking at gaming PCs. I'm a laptop user. I know it sounds crazy, and especially to be streaming, but my laptop is my workhorse, right? So I take it when I go teach, keep it here, play games, right? It's just my everything. So I'm a laptop person. But even looking at like new gaming laptops to have, you know, decent amount of RAM. I currently have 16, but really I'm ready to upgrade to 32. Not to mention, you know, upgrade the GPU as well, and looking at least like 2K for a decent laptop. I've seen some go up to like 3200 plus to get like all the massive specs, and it's just ridiculous. Like I use Asus, and this laptop here is like it just turned 4 years old. So hopefully it can keep it for another year and it not break on me. It's starting to show its age, but we'll see. So I'm going to leave you all again for a quick second. I think I heard my dog at the door. He gets very impatient. I don't blame him. It's hot outside, so he's probably worn himself out. So let me go get him in. So yeah, he actually was not ready to come in. I had to coax him with a treat. But so he's extra happy now, but any of you who also live in Texas, you know how hot it is, so I don't like keeping him out there super long in the summer. So, you know, let him do his business, run around, get some energy, and then so he's very happy now. All right, let's get back to it.
For every massive game developer that are making millions of dollars because they've got 18 different kinds of loot boxes in the game, I'm not thinking about anybody in particular, but any of that kind of stuff, you know, for every one of those, there's hundreds of people, thousands of people out there trying to just make a little game, something, just a little bit of something special, and that's what we really want to empower today and make happen. So I'm excited. I am. I think it's cool, and I'm curious to see what's going to happen with these other games.
Me too. I think these games are looking very good right now, and I also want to say thank you to chat. We are watching. Don't worry. Nick's refreshing live stream fails as we speak. What you guys are saying, and the support is absolutely unreal. Thank you guys so much for being kind to every game and everybody on this stream. It is fantastic. So
Ms. Kiff is farming hearts, so you download his game.
So yes. It comes out winter Smart. 2022 okay. Right now. There's an NFT available.
All right, so you can download that right now. You mint it right now. Put in your password. Do they need to put in their credit card now, or is that later?
You can put it in later. It's fine.
Okay,
don't
great.
Worry about it. PayPal works.
Okay, yeah, just direct to you.
Yeah,
of course. All right, that makes sense, you know, for tax reasons and everything. Emmy, how excited on a scale of 1 to 10 are you to play Mizkif's game?
Like a 3. No, like a 10. It looks sick.
Wow, a 10. Oh, my God, guys. That's so great.
Wow. Oh, good friend.
I was honestly okay with that. What? Just play the game. That's all I care about.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it's fine.
Sorry.
It's whatever.
Anyway, so yeah, thank you guys very much. I appreciate it. And we're going to move on to our next section. But again, guys, I want to remind you just one last time, please make sure to vote in the Discord for the games mm-hmm. that you like the most. There's $50,000 on the line here on top of two PCs made by Razer, powered by Intel. So we're going to go on over to Rich, and we're going to continue the show.
All right. Do we think Mizkif's going to win it? You know, and then, no, I'm pretty sure. I think they kind of had it so no one from OTK, right, could win it, because that would seem very, very sketchy. But hey, just like the previous genre, y'all, let me know in the comments which platformer you're most excited about, what seems to really resonate with you about your choice. And, you know, hopefully you're having a good time. Hopefully, hey, don't forget, please follow the channel. And don't forget, like, subscribe as well. So, all right, let's see what this next genre is and get to it.
I want to give the biggest shout out ever to Razer right now. Them running that ad was the only way that we could get Mizkif to stop talking. But we got a brand new category coming up. It's none other than one of OTK's favorites. It's time to take a look at party games.
Oh, no.
We have a whole bunch of games inside of this category, and we're looking at these right now, thinking about maybe playing them in OTK Game Night. The first one's coming from Chaotic Entertainment, and it is called Minigame Madness.
Oh. Oh. Lots happening. Sorry, it's eyes adjusting. Not great. Oh. Hey, that looks pretty fun, though. Like, I love that kind of stuff.
There is an early demo available for the game right now, so if you want to check it out, and you can play with a few other people you're watching the Games Expo with, you can find some people to play in chat, and for when the full release actually does come out, you can add that to your Steam.
Some people are saying Fall Guys, too.
Anything, but we're going to keep on moving, keep on checking out all of these party games. The next one's coming from a studio called Chua, and the game is called The Matriarch.
I don't know what Asmund's doing with his fingers, hands, but... Whoa. Dang. Oh my god, this is brutal. Yo, I'm digging it. Like, this looks cool. Like, I love a good kind of like, quite literally, like kind of like a witch hunt game. Oh no. Is that Asmongold? Matriarch, alright. Yep.
Did they add that? I did not see that when we watched the trailer.
So, we watched these trailers before. It's new.
It's definitely new.
And that church sure has changed since last time I went. I don't remember the upside down crosses and satanic rituals. Looks a lot more fun.
Looks pretty fun to me, and if you guys want to make sure that you don't miss any of that fun, you can add it to your Steam wishlist right now for when the game is released. And let's take a look at the next one. This one is coming from Fireline Games. Let's take a look at Fuel Up.
Okay, guys, not to completely walk back on what I said before is, I said I'm not a big fan of, like, when you have the bird eye view of everything. I guess that's not entirely true. With games like this, Among Us, I'm fine with it. Like, it's more of when that's the perspective of, like, action shooter games like that we saw earlier, I think that's where I'm not really sold on it. But these kind of, like, party fun games, that's... To me, it's fine. It makes total sense. So, just to clarify on that, because I really do love Among Us and those other, anything that makes you an investigator, finding the person that doesn't fit, right? Cool. Looks great to me. Fueled Up. Yeah.
I could actually talk about that one all day. Very excited to see more. If you are, be sure to add it to your wish list so you don't miss anything. But there is also a download that is available for play today. So you can actually check it out and see it for yourself. And you're also going to see another game right now. This one's coming from RDBK Studios, and it is known as Renown.
Okay. Well, that's some serious music. Wow. Okay. Wow. Oh, that's so awesome. Siege weaponry. So, that looks pretty cool. I wish it would have shown more of like the actual combat perspective, if it's third person or first person. I'm assuming first person, given how some of the other actions were taking place, or hey, maybe you can toggle between. Because it definitely, I was getting some Chivalry 2 vibes. I don't know about y'all if you ever played that. Pretty fun game. I mean, it's just straight up, you know, fighting people. Like it's PvP. But that looks cool. Just forget what it was called, but it was a similar game, very medieval-esque, where you build, you know, you have to build your own buildings, make your own armor, right? Again, similar to like Rust and all those games. But this one seemed pretty fleshed out. I like the fact that, you know, it's really, if you want to lay siege, you actually need to make siege weaponry. You just can't have all these people, you know, with the pickaxe breaking down your fort. Or maybe you can, I don't know. But that, I'm always a huge fan of any kind of like siege warfare. I think that's really cool, especially if you can do it right. So I think this is a game worth checking out.
Sure if McConnell's watching right now, but that game seems right up his alley.
Bro, I'm really excited about that game. That game looks really cool.
It really does.
It looks really cool. I guarantee you, whenever that comes out, me and McConnell are going to be building a castle together in that game. Oh my god, it's exciting. And we get to talk to these guys, right?
You get to right now.
Oh boy, I'm ready. Ooh. Okay, all right, let's go. All right, Jesse, thank you very much for coming on and talking about the game Renown. I'm going to be honest,
no
man.
No problem.
It looks fucking awesome. So, you guys, Rust came out, and it came out a while ago, but it's had like a massive renaissance. Everybody's been playing Rust nowadays. What made you want to do basically medieval Rust?
Well, I mean, it's been, it started probably 8 years ago. I mean, yeah. I went to RMIT, which is a school in Melbourne,
okay.
And I met Charlie, who is the other co-founder of RDBK Studios, and it was actually the first conversation I had with him. He was explaining Rust to me, and it just sounded like the best game ever. I mean, I played it that night until the early hours of the morning, and from that moment, that game was just, for me, the best experience so far. And also, at the same time, we were playing Chivalry Medieval Warfare.
Ah, there it is.
The same sort of vein, the combat system was just so intuitive, and as we played both these games religiously for years, we just kept talking about this medieval survival that, you know, raiding with trebuchets and battering rams and incorporating a directional-based combat system that it just eventually was so good of an idea we couldn't not make it.
I agree.
Then we finished school and we started and, from that point we just built a team and they're just the most dedicated guys. Like, it's unparalleled the quality and speed we get through this stuff. It's fantastic.
I mean, the quality and the speed, that sounds good. When's it going to come out, man?
Okay, so...
The serious
the
question.
The timeline, I guess, from now to release is basically... we've got Steam Next Fest happening on the 13th of June. So very, very soon. And we've got a combat demo that's free for people to play. So we implore you to come and give that a shot. It's just basically the combat version of the game. After that, maybe a month or two past that point, we've got Raid Module, which is, if you imagine you took all the survival systems into a short sort of game mode, we're going to give that to our backers and testers to solidify those systems. It's basically like a small game where two teams fight together, they craft and build their castles and raid, and it's a way we can test all the systems in one place. From there, test and create the full survival game from that testing period. For hopefully a release in early access, maybe mid next year, we hope, but of course these things change, but we can't wait to get it in your hands, that's for sure.
How many people can be on the server? Like, because I think about like a medieval fight, I'm thinking like Kingdom of Heaven, Lord of the Rings, there's a lot of people there. How many?
Well, we're hoping to have 100 players on a server. I mean, we never really envisioned Renown to be this huge battles, or as much as it's cool, I'm sure some people will make some servers where that's possible.
Yeah.
But for us, it was actually like a core, like, community, like a little close-knit clan where you're allying with people around you, fighting over hot spots of resources. It's that sort of like social connections between smaller groups, which we want to capitalize on for sure.
So you have like those small, like, what are you thinking, like 8-man teams, something like that, 4 to 8-man teams?
Exactly, literally, that's exactly what we're balancing to. And then we're going to be hopefully doing our weekly wipe cycles. We might go to bi-weekly, but we think for the replayability, a week works quite well.
Okay, so it's going to be like you're going back and forth.
That's a hard call.
You're getting busted back down. You do it all over again. Is that
basically
it? Okay,
exactly.
Yeah, I'm excited. So June, what was it, 13th? Is that what you said?
That's correct. So Steam Next Fest.
Okay.
Free to play for anyone for about a week. So, and also join our Discord and let us know what you think, because we really need that feedback. We just love to know your thoughts, honestly.
Honestly, man, I'm really excited to see this game. So thank you so much for coming on. Thank you so much for sharing it.
No problem.
I'm really excited.
Thank you so much.
Gonna go.
Me too. Thanks. Thank you.
Absolutely.
Very cool.
And guys, again, Renown, you guys can put it on your wish list now for Steam. But we've got two very well-renowned gamers here. We have S-Fan.
I see what he did there.
And we have Jay Schlatt on to talk about these games. Schlatt, what do you think?
Thank you so much, Asmund. Hold on one second.
Yeah, looks good.
Shroud, you look so good right now, man.
Incredibly handsome.
And look, Asmund, I mean, look, you see a lot of these game genres that go back in time. This is one with Renown. I really feel like this is the perfect fit for it.
Yeah, no, 100%. I think, Asmund, you and I were cut from the same cloth. Knights, armor, big freaking swords. I think Renown looks really, really exciting. You know, it's just one of those games.
I'm so excited. Like, I remember I first started playing Rust whenever they had that first server that we made
on
Twitch with everybody on it. And like,
so I think it's safe to say we know which of these games they're definitely leaning towards as far as, you know, being their favorite. But again, it's thankfully it's not completely up to them. Like just like I'm doing here, talking about personal preference. A lot of this game speaks to me. Very excited to see, you know, obviously if they get all the feedback, work out a lot of the, you know, any bugs, any potential issues with playthrough. I'm thinking about the whole, you know, 100-person servers. I mean, that means at least one thing, like the lag will hopefully be, you know, it'll never be too hectic. Like, as y'all have seen, if you watched any of the Diablo Immortal playthroughs, doing zone events with like, you know, 15, 20 people, and my game, it becomes a lot for my laptop to handle. Again, I know part of it's it being a laptop, but when, you know, I'm just by myself, it's really not an issue. So I think 100 will help limit that. And it sounds like I couldn't quite tell if it was between 4 or 8 people, like in a, you know, a guild or a clan or whatever. Like if that's all you can have, I think that's interesting. I wonder if that means then to like be able to construct, you know, whether it be castles or any sort of like fortifications, you know, how much material is that going to require? Let alone, you know, building siege equipment. I think that's going to be a major telltale sign of, you know, how well player interaction will go, right? And also, how big is the world going to be on the server? I mean, if you only have 100 people, it can't be too too large. Also, I am going to be very curious to see if they add different, you know, areas, different zones. Like, are there going to be like snow areas, desert areas, or, I mean, again, I know it's still like a year roughly between, you know, before they really start getting release date and all that set. So maybe right now all they're going to have is a forest. Obviously, you need wood to construct a lot of things. So in a desert or frozen tundra, you probably won't find that as much. Understand that. So, but I think this game has a lot of potential. I'd love kind of like what they've been saying. Huge fan of this kind of playthrough, so looking forward to seeing what comes of this game.
Like, I had such a good time. I would steal everybody's horse on that server. It was great. It was one of my favorite things to do. I would take a day off a stream just so I could run around and hide under somebody's base and break it down. But like this, it's like especially... No, really, that's what I did. I would steal those things. I'd run them back to my stable.
I remember. I was playing. I would log in, and I think the first time I encountered your stable... Yeah. I was just running around like off the side of a beach or something, and I see this big house, and I open it, and there's just horses lined up, and everybody's getting their horses stolen. They have no idea where they're going, and it's just, Asmund literally has like 20 horses sitting in this stable, and just you're a horse thief. I mean, you're collecting mounts even in Rust.
I like that. Horses,
well, usually, like I would honestly, the thing is that
that's cool.
A bigger team because we employed one person just to feed all the horses.
Wow.
Yeah, like that, we turned this into an industry. So I'm really curious to see what I'm curious to see what this is gonna be. Like,
customization's huge to me, and I'm digging that. That's pretty sweet. Customization options.
I look at the graphics, I look at the way the game plays, wow. And it's like, I mean, I see chopping down trees. Yeah. I'm thinking of, you know, just that new world late night experience, yep. Sitting in the dark. And so I just am so excited to see this game.
Whoa.
But there's a number of other ones as well. Like, yeah.
There's so many good ones here.
Which ones do you like?
Well, I mean, Fueled Up looks fantastic. Mm-hmm. Literally just Overcooked in space. I mean, that's the better formula than that.
Yeah. Well, I think the big thing too is we'll just tell them the truth. Guys, we need some stream content, you know? And we do our game nights every Wednesday. We do our OTK game nights every Wednesday, and we're looking at all these party games. And even when we were going through the trailers, we were like, dude, we got to play this one. We got to play this one. And I know, I mean, all these games, really, but you mentioned Fueled Up, Minigame Madness, Matriarch. I mean, you name it. And even unfortunately, some things that we don't even get to show in the expo. There were just so many good submissions. We had to narrow it down for the sake of the show. I mean, absolutely.
Yeah. Wow.
And, you guys see, we've got a lot of the really, really good ones here. And I have to say, I like Fueled Up too as well. Mm-hmm, like absolutely. It was a lot like the, and especially the OTK game night. Like I am so sick of you guys playing Gang Beasts and throwing me off the edge. I'm tired of this, man. Like what's going on?
That's a brutal game.
Gang Beasts. So far, I'd wanted to play Gang Beasts like every week because I basically just get to go harass Asmund, which is one of my favorite pastimes. I literally throw me off the edge. It's like, I feel like Palpatine.
Imagine Minigame Madness in real life. If we had OTK game night in real life, had everyone in like Antarctica,
and just pushing each other off cliffs,
exactly.
Yeah. Why not? What could go wrong? Yeah.
No, I personally, I'd love to play Minigame Madness with Ludwig. Ludwig, you down, man?
Oh my god!
Just kidding.
Yeah.
Yeah. No thanks, man.
We'll let you know.
Jeez.
Yeah.
I don't know. I've got to say, like, I am so excited about this Renown game. I think that this type of survival game, especially like team-based survival games where it's like PvP and it's in a medieval setting, I am just so hyped up for that. So I might actually even play the combat demo because I think it's one of those games, like, especially with something like Renown, what really makes a game like that, you know, fun is that, you know, you've got a 1 week, 2 week wipe cycle. So it's mainly about like building up and like the play experience on a day-to-day basis. So like
making sure
that is like pristine, on point, precise, and fun to do. I think that if you do that, everything else just fits together.
I think fresh.
Wow. Sorry, y'all. I know pausing a lot for this game, but I a lot of what they're saying I agree with. Get away from the pillar. But check out that just courtyard. Castle life. And the reason I like the wipe cycle is, you know, if you get a group that they just begin to dominate, and it's like if you never wiped the server, then they could just keep expanding the castle, right? And then you get these huge, basically, like, you know, it'd be a citadel, like, or, you know, larger even than that, almost like a little city. And then it ruins the fun, you know, you have this huge fortress and only, you know, a few people defending it, kind of, I don't know, it kind of takes away from the fun. So I think, you know, weekly or bi-weekly wipe, it's just nice. Resets everything. People can try new tactics, right? Because you're not spending, you know, months on a server trying to break into the same fortress. Because guess what? That gets old and then people leave the game. So I think it's fantastic. You know, this whole, again, these wipe cycles just keeps reinvigorating the game. Lets you start anew, you know, get into a new groove. Yeah, I think it's just fun. I think it's awesome.
Like whenever you get a chance to wipe it and go fresh and start from the beginning, it's fun for everybody. Because you have people that
go figure, right?
They just like going fresh and they like just from the beginning over and over and over again. Yeah. Or there's people that were like, oh, I didn't do well on the last wipe and these are all my excuses. These are all my reasons. But this time I'll do
it's
good.
It's going to be different this time.
They're in the cycle, dude. They're in the cycle.
Oh, I'm going to get all the sniper rifles this time. It's going to be okay. But, yeah, guys, listen, I got to remind y'all again, listen, go to the Discord, OTK Network Discord. There is $50,000 in grants, not pledges, grants, that's going to be going out to these different developers, and you vote on the winners. So make sure to do that, OTK Discord. And on top of that, each one of the prizes comes with a Razer PC that's powered by Intel. And again, we'll throw it back over to Rich, and we'll start going to the next section.
Yeah,
Yeah. We are going to do just that. Now, we've never done this before at an OTK Games Expo, but this category is actually dedicated to a pioneer, one of my personal heroes, and a man who, well, a very brave man who has managed to touch all of us and inspire all of us. A man with beautiful aim and an even more beautiful smile. This category
Shroud?
Is dedicated to Shroud.
Got it.
Let's take a look at Shooter.
All right, sorry, before we get too much into it, remember, just with all genres, y'all, let me know what how you felt about that last genre. What game stood out to you? What are you most excited to play? Some very different styles going on. So, again, very excited. You know where my, you know, what my favorite obviously is, right? That renowned game. Super looking hyped for that. But, yeah, let me know down in the comments. I'd love to read, love to chat more about it. All right, so let's see the shooter genre.
I think I actually might be the bad guy in this next game. It's made by Mopul Games, and it's called Fashion Police Squad.
Interesting. Oh, shit. You got freaking Spider-Man with the belt. You just throw a baby? Oh, Dude, what is this game?
But we're going to take a look at the next game. This one's from Dids, and it's called Project Sparrow.
Huh. Whoa. Do I think it looks cool? Absolutely. Is it a game I play? No, because I'd be horrible at it. Ooh, those are some sick armor choices. Project Sparrow, okay.
Two very different games right now to kick off the shooters, but they do have one thing in common. You can play both of them right now. So when you actually do look at Fashion Police Squad, you can play the early demo. You can download that right now on Steam. But for Project Sparrow, you can download the entire game. So if you want to check them both out, you can head over to Steam and play them both today. But we're already starting to see shooters are going to have a pretty large variety. A lot of things falling under this umbrella. We got two more games to check out, but we're going to take a deep dive on Project Sparrow. Asmin is with the game developer right now for an interview.
Okay. I mean, I'm going to be honest, guys. Like, I feel like this is the kind of game that I would get my ass beat in. Like, it's like you have to be so precise with the shots. And I'm really excited to see kind of like, where did this game really come from? What was the inspiration for it? And kind of what's your story in making this game?
Yeah, so
about 5 years ago, I just really wanted to make, well, there was no games that were had bows and arrows or anything like that, so I just wanted to make a shooter game that had bows, just a sick game.
So it's a shooter game, and like, there's like customizing your arrows and your bow. Like, what's the kind of stuff that you can do? Are there special abilities? Like, what's really on the table here?
Yeah, so at the start of every round, there's 13 rounds in a game, first to seven. At the start of each round, you can pick an arrow type. So you've got like fire arrows, shadow arrows, and smoke arrows. So you can like shadow arrow, TP, shoot your enemy from behind. You've got a utility section as well that you can pick from. So you can choose if you want a smoke bomb or a satchel or a throwing knife. Just pretty much help your playstyle rather than just having abilities that one-shot you. So that's kind of the gist of the game.
Yeah, I mean, I see it, and it just seems like it's like so precise and so fast. I can't even imagine like other abilities. So you can teleport around, and like, what does a fire arrow do? Does it kind of just like shut down a certain area on the map, or what?
Yeah, so you just fire a fire arrow. You just swap to it with your arrow type, and then wherever it hits, it makes a fire like AOE.
Okay.
So if you've got someone who's 3Ping you and they won't move out of cover, you just fire arrow. They have to move, and then you can shoot them.
Is there a team version of this? Like, I think a lot of these were 1v1. Can you do with the teams as well?
Yeah, so there's 1v1s, 2v2s, 3v3s. You can warm up in death matches as well. There's custom games and spectator mode as well. So.
Oh, wow. Okay, so this is the kind of game that, like, you can pretty much, if you're a fan of FPS and just, like, the the fickle nature of, like, moving around and being super precise, this is a game for people that are aficionados of that, people that really...
And I am not one of those people.
Unironically, which was never intended, but the movement in the game is just been getting harder and harder, and it's really hard to master the movement in Project Sparrow now.
Okay.
But, through playtesting, we just kept adding, new stuff, wall bouncing, and then dashes, and then being able to dash in the air, and then it's just, it's really fluid if you can master the movement.
Yeah, I can see that. I think it's absolutely one of those games that just becomes harder and harder to play the longer that you play it. So I want to say thank you so much for coming on. And again, Project Sparrow is available now on Steam. Is that right?
Yep, Steam Early Access, 20% off right now as well.
There you go. Thank you very
much
for coming on.
Y'all heard it.
Your game, and good luck on development.
Thank you very much for having me. Cheers, guys.
I'm gonna be honest, like, if I ever play that game, I cannot wait for like my the like seven people that I have that are under 18 that watch my stream to just like instantly kill me in it.
Yeah.
Like I just
We're very similar. We both like playing shooters, but we're both terrible at them.
Yeah.
Huh.
You agree?
I think a lot of people agree with that.
We got two more games left in the shooter category. Let's jump right in. This one comes from Two Star Games, and this one's a little bit spooky. It's called Choo Choo Charles.
Ooh. Choo Choo Charles. Whoa. Oh, hell no. No, 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 no. Now, I can already tell y'all people are going to be playing this game at night, like, streaming, getting some content, getting some jump scares, I'm sure. Oh. Dude. Dirty country, man. Funny joke. Okay. Hey, I love when you get upgrades and they actually, like, appear in the game. Oh. Oh, man, that is just horrifying. You know, I wonder if it's multiplayer.
Now, let's talk to a few of the worst. We're gonna go up to the Variety Gaming panel.
Ouch.
Not gonna lie, I'm actually getting quite mad at Rich for
calling me bad. In reality, actually, the two best gamers in all of OTK are here. It is me and Finn. Finn has replaced Chance. Good to see you, brother.
Wow. Good to see you, too. Thank you so much for the introduction. I'm very proud.
Yes,
not part of this variety.
Don't touch me.
I'm sorry.
Not only did we get to watch that awesome fight between friends down there, we also got to see some awesome FPS games. We watched, we got to see Fashion Police Squad, Project Sparrow, Choo Choo Charles, Hold Fast, Nations at War. You know, which game stuck out to you guys?
How about you?
You know what I'm thinking. First. I want to hear your opinion.
Me?
Yeah.
You, I'm supposed to just. You
I feel like the fashion game fits you. You know,
what?
I thought that would be your favorite.
Oh.
The fashion game was great. It was a 2D game. You know, it was, you know, fun, lighthearted.
Game using like 2D, like pixel
right.
art. So it's kind of cool. The art
exactly.
style in that game stuck out to me a lot.
That's more of Finn's alleyway.
Yeah. I'm not into the fashion. You know,
I've seen
got
the Burberry
my best shirt out here.
Yeah,
I like it. I like the graphics and I like the guns. The gameplay is just.
Do I think it's unique? Absolutely. I think gameplay looks pretty smooth. Very cool premise, right? I think, again, this is going to be a very unique game. Just one, me and shooters, not like in this kind of, you know, style. Again, just not for me. Same with the whole Project Sparrow. Not just not my cup of tea. Like, I'm just not great at shooters. I know that's part of the reason. Well, I've just always been more of a MMO, RTS, you know, RPG kind of player. So I think this game's, you know, pretty unique, stylized, and just the whole concept is fantastic. But I can tell y'all right now, the only game that I actually would buy and play myself would probably be the whole the train, the was it, Choo Choo Charles or whatever, because that's. That's some stuff of nightmares, but it seems like a nice little fun adrenaline rush.
Yeah, my favorite thing about this is actually the golden toilet, because the best time for me is when I'm able to use the bathroom and, you know, recharge.
You ever used a bidet?
I used to.
Crazy.
Yeah, I used to, but I had to stop using it. I spent too much time on it.
Not a bidet guy myself, personally. See
here? Yeah, change your life.
Nick, help me with the name, because I was down there preparing for battle. What's a choo-choo game?
Choo-choo Charles?
Yeah.
So Choo-choo Charles is a game. It's actually like...
I was watching that. That is
scary.
A game I will play.
I actually am I'm afraid of playing horror games.
What do you think about the choo-choo with the spider legs, like running full
so
force?
So when I was growing up, Thomas the Tank was like my thing growing up. And this
I
just,
can tell.
So you was one of those.
Yeah.
Was that?
Ouch.
Yeah, I could tell.
Jeez.
Thomas the Tank.
That's like one of the worst shows.
Yeah, it's just a personality trait. You know?
So
I'm more of a Chuggington type of guy.
I never even heard of that.
You see? Too old.
Okay. Yeah, but so Choo Choo Charles, it's a scary train game. You know, it's a FPS game. You can, you know, level up your train as you go, as you can see here.
So I love games where you basically build up the armor of the train,
yeah.
And you also have to make sure the train keeps going, right?
I don't know, but you can.
It looks like bad guys will get you if the train doesn't keep going.
Yeah, I'm not even sure how you win this. This might be one of those games where you're just surviving.
I think when
you
get to Ohio, that's
like a surviving tactic.
Yeah, a little note. There seems to be a navigation element to this game too. That's really interesting. The integration of the map features.
I agree.
Yeah.
Oh shh.
Yeah, this train is horrifying. Like, look at it. That is absolutely scary.
Any scary shooter game needs a good antagonist, and that thing is nightmare fuel.
Yep.
So I'm impressed.
So, Finn, how'd you feel about Hold Fast Nations at War?
Well, this game has been established and already has an incredible community. That's what I know about this game. I've spent hours watching gameplay videos, YouTube, all hilarious. The player interactions that game.
That belt whip, dude. kind of like a bull whip. My God. That's.
I love Hold Fast.
Well, this is not Hold Fast, but it's also a good game.
How I felt about Hold Fast. I'm not really a fan of beans on TV. Shit like that.
Me neither.
Beans,
you know,
on
it's unacceptable.
But I like the game, you know? It's a pretty cool
game. What do you mean,
I feel
beans
like
on
it's
toast?
It's UK.
Is that what they eat?
What?
Beans on toast.
Oh.
Surprisingly.
I think, yeah. That's
How do
you have
you
ever eaten beans on toast?
Absolutely not. I don't eat, no.
Okay.
I don't even eat eggs.
I have a question.
Yeah.
Do you think that you would be good at any of these games?
Personally, and I mean this without no cap.
Okay.
I would be in the top 0.01%
of every single one of these games, I am better than Shroud.
There you have it.
Fighting words.
Ooh.
Fighting words coming out of Nick.
So.
Shroud shot?
Yeah. He knows.
Yeah.
I like Shroud.
Yeah, he's cool.
Yeah.
Shroud.
Finn, anything else you wanna add?
I'm talking about Project Sparrow as well. We haven't mentioned that one yet. The arena-based shooter also looking pretty spicy. Anything that has to do with movement and projectile combat, I'm interested in. And this game seems to have those elements. It's looking fun.
That's what
it looks pretty clean, just not my style.
You put me in that hot seat, and guaranteed I'm going to be at the top of the charts. I've been playing FPS professionally for years.
I used to be a trick shotter, Black Ops 2, you know, when I was like 12 years old. So I like the high rise, you know, things that they could jump off of and also like spin around. I like seeing that. It's interesting to me.
If you want me to be completely honest, if I actually played this game, I am not good with arrows and projectiles. This is the one game that I actually wouldn't be in the top in. In fact, I would probably be the worst at this game. I just don't know how to like lead my shots and
so fast.
Never really.
You're like that with guns as well in games, right?
But you're more of a sit down to pee type of guy.
How'd you do that?
I do it too.
Okay. Yeah, absolutely. Finn, how do you think you do at Project Sparrow?
I think I do great, Nick. I think I do super good in that arena based game.
Not great, but super good. That's
the game immediately.
And then it's beddy by time for Nick, huh?
Yeah.
Okay.
Take it right to bed.
It's roughly 6:30.
All right. Well, guys, Finn, anything else you want to add?
Yeah.
Okay.
I have no idea what that was. But okay, that's the voice crack. Honestly, I only really saw one game that really seemed to spur my interest. So, interesting, nonetheless.
Let's get back to Rich.
That was awesome.
Hello, I'm back on the stage. It's time to take a look at the simulation games. Let's jump right into the action with the first one. Never mind, we're not jumping right into the first one. Asmin, I went to the wrong left.
Yeah, you did.
Thank you for covering.
Supposed to go to the other side?
Yeah, I was supposed to go to the other side, man.
Oh, just a fail.
I'm a human. But if there was a game that simulated life, I could play it and potentially get better at real life through a simulation. And that's exactly what we do have as we start to take a look at this section. The first game is coming from Filament Games, and it is...
All right, y'all. We're going to cut it for a while. It's been fantastic. Loving the Game Expo. We're only halfway through. So you know what that means. We're going to have another segment of reactions, checking out all these fantastic games. Remember, again, be sure to go vote. They talked about it multiple times throughout the Expo. Honestly, I think this has been going fantastic. I think OTK has been doing a wonderful job. Just the whole premise of helping independent developers, potentially really, get a huge investment that can be, it's substantial, right? Having that support as well as getting their names out there, right? Their games out there, just bringing about that awareness. I think this has been overall a very successful event. And looking forward to chatting about it with y'all in the next one. So again, I'm Dr. Duality. Please remember to give a follow. I'd really appreciate it. Helps out the channel. And until the next one, I will see y'all later. Thank you.